Hello everyone and welcome to EBTV. My name is Avita O'Shell and joining me today is returning guest Tom Campbell. Tom, hello and what an amazing gift to have you back again.
Well, thank you, Avita. It's my pleasure to be here. Thank you.
You're very welcome. And so for anyone who may have missed the last time we spoke together, it was at the start of 2012 and it was a wonderful video where we had the pleasure of having you talk for over 3 hours, in fact, and cover so many outstanding topics when it came to life, understanding the nature of our reality, and just so many fascinating topics that stem from those two areas. Now, today we are going to take things on a more practical level, as of course you yourself are seeing and know so many people have so many now questions as to how to make sense of your work, specifically MBT and the virtual reality idea, on a daily, everyday sort of type of life and put it into practice. So as we begin to talk about that, I will just quickly share with our audience, for anyone who is not familiar with Tom's work, since this will be practical applications of his work, definitely it is in your best interest to start with some of Tom's other lectures and work that describe and explain in detail the nature of his work. And of course, your book, Tom, which we will be mentioning, is also another option. And of course, for those who are familiar with it, this is where we are picking up with the assumption that the audience is already familiar with the ideas of a virtual reality and is now going to be learning on how to put these into everyday practice. So I will, though, still share that, Tom, you are a leading researcher and authority on consciousness, reality, and out-of-body experience, and you have been studying this for over 30 years. And of course, you are also a physicist, lecturer, and author of the book My Big Toe, which is a trilogy and is available in paperback, hardcover, as well as for free on Google Books, and will eventually be also an audiobook. So it is available in various formats. So as we start today, Tom, of course, the idea when we think about everything that you have brought forth to us, the idea of a virtual reality seems to come down so much to our perception. And this is, I find, something that is common to so many other areas of thought throughout the centuries, like ancient writing, that it seems to be, you know, when we look for the answers to life and such, it's all about perception. How do we increase our perception? Because perception is makes the difference between a good day and a bad day, something beautiful or something ugly, to be more in alignment with our true nature.
Perception. Excuse me, I'm going to be clearing my throat off and on through this, so I hope your listeners will forgive me, but my throat's just a little worn out doing this audiobook. Anyway, perception is a confusing term because it actually contains, I'd say, at least five different concepts that kind of combine into this thing we call perception. Perception can be expanded or constrained, and that's really what you're talking about. How do we expand our perception, and how do we understand that what we are perceiving is really because of our constraints on that perception? So I want to reframe perception in terms of the things that expand or constrain it, okay? And that will give us a better understanding of it. Well, the first thing, obviously, that constrains our perception is our physical sensor capabilities. Okay, so we all have eyes, ears, nose, you know, these sorts of things that limit our capabilities. And what we're doing when we sense with our sensory apparatus is we're just getting data. Okay, we're getting information, and that information is digital. It turns into, say, pulses on the optic nerve, you know, or pulses on the audio nerves. And then when we get that data, we have to interpret it. Okay, so then that would be number two on our list of things that help us expand or constrain our perception. Number two is the interpretation of data perceived, and that's from whatever source. Now, our eyes and ears and so on, that's just the physical data stream that we're involved in. But our perception is broader than that. With our perception, we can also include data from our intuition and from sources other than just this physical reality. So interpretation from whatever the source. Three is focus. what you perceive has a lot to do with what you focus on. Okay. And it has a lot to do with your intent. Okay. What you intend to see, expectations. Okay. The extent of your awareness. Okay. All those things will affect your perception. If you're not focused on, well, you know, all of us will sometimes get in a car and drive someplace, and then when we get there, we kind of wake up and say, I don't remember that trip at all, right? Well, that's because we weren't focused on it. Even though we were making the right turns, applying the brake and the power when we needed it, we just weren't focused on what was going on, and therefore all of the perceptions excuse me, all the perceptions of that trip are kind of not there. So what we perceive has a lot to do with our focus and our intent. Where is our intent? What do we intend to focus? What are we intending to get out? Our intent and our awareness and our focus are all limited by fear, ego, beliefs, expectations. Okay, so we can only focus in areas that our beliefs allow us to focus. If we believe that such and such a, you know, information is not available or isn't open to us, like our intuition, ah, bah, intuition, what's that? You know, humbug. That doesn't exist. That's just people, you know, imagining things. So if you have that kind of a belief, then obviously you're not going to get data through that channel because your belief circumscribes it, says it doesn't exist. Same with expectation. Same with expectation. If you're expecting certain kinds of data, you will exclude all the rest of what data you could be experiencing and perceiving, because that expectation will crowd everything else out. But that, you know, that's the thing. Like you go looking for something that you lost, and because you're looking for a piece of yellow paper, this is what you thought it was written on, and it turns on it's on a piece of white paper. You can't find it, even though it's lying right there in front of your desk on top, you know, looking at you. It's because your expectation walls that out. So you just can't see it, even though it's in front of you, because your expectation has you looking for something else. Okay, so fear, ego, beliefs, expectation are the big limiters of our perception. Okay, now the size of your awareness is proportional to the size of your decision space, which also defines the size of your reality. That's another thing that affects perception, is the size of your reality. And all these things kind of work together. So if you have a very small reality, then there's only a few things that you can perceive in that reality. If you have a very large reality, then your perception can expand over many, many, many different, you know, sources, if you will. Okay, and finally, our perception is limited very much by our knowledge, our understanding, our wisdom, which is the quality of our consciousness. Ignorance perceives a very restricted set of possibilities, right? If you're ignorant, then the set of possibilities is small. So that's a small decision. That makes a small decision space, which makes a small reality, which then limits the perception. So yes, perception is important, but we have to see that it's not just, okay, there's the stuff out there, and then our perception sees it. There's a lot of things that we bring to the table that limits that perception. And mostly that's fear, ego, beliefs, expectations. And in that list, actually, ego is a derivative of fear, and expectations are a derivative of beliefs. So we're really talking about fear and belief are the root things that kind of shut us off from our possible interactions with not only this physical reality, but with the larger reality as well. So yes, it is just a matter of perception. You know, when we do an out of body or we do remote viewing, it's just a matter of perception. But we have all these personal issues that we bring to the table that limit our ability to perceive what's there. Then when we do perceive something, it starts to color that perception with our interpretation of the data. So you see, there's lots of problems with the, you know, with perception and what it means to us. And it's not an open and closed kind of thing like most people might think. It's just like, open your eyes and see it. Well, you can't see it if you have a belief or an expectation or a fear that blocks it out of your vision. You can't just open your eyes and see it. And to tell somebody to do that, or to think that they're stupid because they don't, is just ego, you know, on our part. We have to realize that our perception is very limited by our attitudes and by our understandings and how much knowledge we have and so on. Mm-hmm. Now, the key is, what do we do about it? As one grows up, one's reality, perception, interpretation, knowledge, wisdom, all of that expands. Okay, fear, ego, beliefs, expectations reduce. So the idea is grow up. And as you grow up, you don't have to actually do a whole lot to increase that perception and that quality of what you get. It just happens. Because as you grow up, the ego and beliefs disappear. The fear goes away. And as that goes away, what's left? Love, caring, you know, all the good stuff that opens you up, gives you a larger reality, increases your perception. And suddenly, these things that you really wanted to perceive, you know, I'd really like to perceive auras. I'd really like to understand people better and understand my effect on them. But people don't, you know, people want to understand, you know, the opposite sex better. You know, how is it that those men think or those women think, and why do they do and say what they do? And all these things seem to be hidden from us, but yet they're only hidden because we shut them out. We're only hidden because we're not open to them. Once you grow up, then all of that stuff just is easy. The remote viewing, the out of body, it's not a matter of some kind of magic thing that you do. It's just a matter of perception. It's just a matter of opening your mind to that possibility and experiencing it. It really is much simpler than it sounds. People try and try to do things that they find are almost impossible. You know, if not hard, they get discouraged. But it's because they don't understand that they are the block, you know, right, that they have to doing things. It's not that this darn technique doesn't work. It's that they don't let it work. They're the ones that's in the way. And if you are not ready, you might as well let it go, because it'll just frustrate you. Mm-hmm. So rather than get frustrated, I really want, you know, to have access to this information, and you're frustrated because you don't have it, that will just make it harder to get. Better to just say, well, let me stop worrying about getting access to information, and let me just worry about growing up and finding my fears and my ego and getting rid of them. And then the access, you see, will just happen all by itself. So we tend to get the cart in front of the horse sometimes and pursue the perception when we really ought to be pursuing our own spiritual growth, our own growing up.
That is really, really, really important to hear. And the ramifications of this are, as I'm sure anybody listening, are huge, not just in how we relate to each other, to ourselves, to this reality, the other realities, etc. But it really comes down to, as you said, you know, so many times we speak the language that we understand, you know, perhaps as English or any other language on this planet, and we think we're all talking about the same thing, but we're not. And as you so beautifully just pointed out, even with the word perception, there's so many different layers to it. So Tom, when it comes then to, of course, living this and applying it on an everyday kind of life basis, before we get into seeing and understanding how this applies to our work, to our food choices, to our relationships, etc., of course, another governing foundation, so to speak, is people's ideas, and this comes back to the idea of beliefs and fears about the subject of morality, about the ideas of these hard-coded right and wrong, whether it deals with our work choices, our food choices, our relationships, you know, anything. How can we broaden that, or you know, I understand that it's not about telling some people, well, you know, you should just forego all ideas about morality. But where does, you know, the virtual reality sort of fit in with knowing how to do the so-called right things, but not being limited by them?
Okay. First of all, we talk about application. And if the theory doesn't have applications basically everywhere to everything, if there aren't these direct applications, then the theory is either poor or you don't understand it. You know, theory can't just exist on its own. It's only useful if it applies to people in their everyday things. So yes, you'll find my big toe isn't just a theory that is meant for, you know, intellects to talk about, you know, over drinks. It's not that at all. It's about being. It's about living. this right or wrong is a problem for people because they don't know how to differentiate sometimes between right or wrong. It gets confusing. You know, would this be right? You know, is it right for me to do this or that? And how do I know? Well, as it turns out, the My Big Toe concepts lead to a, what's called in philosophy, a moral code, to where it defines what's right and what's wrong. And it's a very simple definition. Right is whatever lowers your entropy and moves you toward being love, period. And, you know, right is whatever gets rid of fear, ego, beliefs, and expectations. So then that's simple. If you look at any situation that you're involved in and you have a moral choice, then the choice is between what choice do I make that moves me and the rest of the system. That's everybody. Mm-hmm. And that's not everybody just physical. That's everybody physical and non-physical. You know, the whole system moves toward evolving, toward love, if I make this choice. Because sometimes a choice will say, well, the choice is good for A, B, and C, but bad for D, E, and F, you see. Well, you have to look at the whole picture. It's not just, is it good for me? Is it good for the system? Is it good for everybody? And is that good long-term or short-term? Short-term is neither here nor there. We're all, you know, take two steps forward, one step back. You know, we're all doing different things in the short-term. But in the long-term, what is this going to do in the long-term? And if it lowers entropy, if you get rid of fear and ego beliefs, then that's right. That's the right thing to do. If it creates more entropy, which means more angst, you know, more anger, okay, more fear, that kind of thing, then it's a high entropy thing, then it's wrong. So that's how we define right and wrong and kind of make up a moral code.
So it's, I guess, important not to get caught again for people in dogmas or, you know, our man-made physical reality constructs here. But as you're saying, almost like looking at the bigger picture, right?
Yes. And the important thing here is that right and wrong is not a function of what you do. It's not a function of the action. It's not that this is a right action and a wrong action so much as it is the motivation, why you do it. That's where the right and wrong comes in. If you do something because you know, if you're doing something that is love-based, you just do it, and then you just let the actions come out however they do. You see, you don't have to worry about what's going to be the result. If I do this, then they'll do that. Then, you know, that's a waste of your of your energy. That's you trying to control things by, you know, that's, I guess, comes under the topic of manipulation. You want to do things that cause other people to react certain ways or not react those ways. Just do it. If it's a love-based thing, if that's your motivation, then whatever the action is, sorry about my voice, but whatever the action is, it'll be good. You see, it'll work out. I had a young woman talk to me, this is many years ago, and she was about to have a child, and she says, this child-rearing thing is scary. Says, how will I know, you know, what to do, how to raise this child? Because I know you can hurt children just by, you know, too much attention or too little attention. And it seems that it's just very difficult to find out what to do. And my advice to her was, get your own head on straight first. Get rid of your fear. Get rid of your beliefs. And then just do what comes natural. And it will be right, both for you and the child. And you need to approach all life that way. Get your own head on straight. Don't try to figure it out. Don't make it an intellectual left brain analysis. Just do what's right. That means do what's love-based. Get rid of the fear, get rid of the ego, and be yourself.
Yeah.
And after that, if you do something that's a mistake, well, you'll learn from it. And everybody will learn from it. If you do something that's wonderful, well, you'll learn from that too.
Mm-hmm.
Life is a learning adventure. Don't be afraid to do, you know. We have to do. That's what we're here for, to interact. But make sure as best you can that the doing is based on the right intent. It's what you intend to accomplish. And if what you're intending is a manipulation, well, if I do this, that'll cause that. Or if I don't do this, then this will happen. What will they think? How am I going to make this person think the way I want them to think and do what I want them to do? That's all wrongheaded. Mm-hmm. That's not, and we trick ourselves in sometimes into saying, well, I'm just doing that for their own good. You know, I know this is what's best for them.
Yeah.
So, I'll do this because that will force them to do what's good for them. And that's not about them. That's about you, not about them. So, you have to actually be thinking of others, not just pretending to be thinking of others.
Mm-hmm. And that's something which you last pointed out that I'd love to, again, we'll bring up when we get more into the idea of parenting. Because with parents, there's often that fine line between, well, I'm doing it because it's best for them, but actually what they think is best for another is actually hurting the other and hurting them in the process. But we'll get to that later. So, Tom, another big aspect that is part of our every single day seems to be this drive, the purpose of life, or why we do anything. Of course, our society today is, I would almost say, you know, obsessed about productivity and success and getting things done. How is this fitting into the idea of the my big toe ideas that you, of course, present? Or just, you know, is there anything that we really have to do? Because so many people live day to day thinking that I have to do this, or I have to get this promotion, or I have to celebrate a holiday a certain way, or I have to.
Okay, well, is there anything we really have to do? That's a, both a yes and a no. It's a no in the sense of it's really about being, not doing. You know, there are things that you need to be much more than there are things you need to do. Because once the being is correct, the doing takes care of itself. You don't have to worry about the doing if the being is right. So, no, there's nothing you really have to do if, except be, and, you know, be from a position of love and caring and make it about others, not about your fear and your beliefs. So, obviously, being is the primary thing, not the doing. But on the, in the other sense, you know, it's yes in the sense of you need to make an effort to get rid of the fear and ego. Now, we might call that a doing thing. You need to make an effort. You can't just go through life, you know, consuming and interacting without really making an effort to improve the quality of your interaction or even the quality of your consumption. You know, it's not just, you're not like a, you know, a locust, you know, going from, you know, farm field to farm field, devouring what's around. Mm-hmm. You have to think, what can I do to make this better for others? How is it that I can be that is of more value, more help, you know, to yourself and to others? So you need a desire or an intent. You need to make a free will choice to grow up. You don't just grow up by hanging out. Well, you do a little. Maybe you grow down as well as up. You may evolve or de-evolve if you just hang out. But if you want to make real progress, if you want to open that that perception and that size of your reality that we talked about, live in a larger reality instead of a smaller reality, then you do need to make a choice to grow up. Mm-hmm. And you need to make a choice to find those fears that are pushing you, to find those beliefs that are limiting you. And this is something that really does take a fair amount of effort, and it is a good thing to do. But in the sense of all the things that our culture tells us that we need to do, most of that is nonsense. You know, I need to have a house in the suburbs, two cars, you know, 2.5 children, you know, et cetera, et cetera. You know, these are the things you feel you need to do to be doing it right. And none of that's very important. Again, ask why. You want, you know, what's the intent behind the doing?
Mm-hmm.
That's what's really important, not the doing. You can't really grow up by doing anything in particular. It's a being thing. You know, this idea that, well, I'll take this training course, I'll read this book, and then, you know, that will make me a better person. Nothing makes you a better person except you desiring and having the intent to be a better person and changing yourself. That's the only way to become a better person.
Right.
And many of us chase all sorts of prescriptions for how to improve ourselves. And we take courses on out of body, and we take courses on, you know, influencing people and how to, you know, how to interact and how we should be and so on. But that's, you know, that's not really where you get change. You don't get change because somebody explains the problem to you. You get change because you want to change and you make a change. You purposely make a change in yourself because you know this is better. That's where it comes from. So many people come back from these seminars and, oh, they're all pumped up about it for the first week or two. And yeah, a month later, everything is just exactly the way it was. You know, nothing has really changed because it all was in the intellect, not at the being level.
Yes.
Yeah, the intellect is not the place to change. It's, you know, that's not really where the understanding needs to happen. The understanding needs to happen at the being level. At the intellectual level, we can convince ourselves of all sorts of things. We can even, you know, convince ourselves that we are beautiful, wonderful, loving people, you know, have no ego and no fear and, you know, deserve a gold star next to our name. But that doesn't make it so. You actually have to be it, not act it. It's not about acting. It's about who you are. So, yes, you do have to do some things, but the main things you have to do are grow up. And the way you do that is take seriously the finding and getting rid of your fear and beliefs.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, I find this so common, especially as the spiritual movement or the personal evolution movement has been growing really exponentially, as I see it, for the past few years. So many people do, you know, pursue paths of self-realization or awakening through whether it's, you know, Indian mysticism or ancient philosophies or whatever the route may be to it. And yet so many people come back to exactly the same thing saying, well, it didn't do anything for me. It must not work. But they're refusing to take responsibility and accountability for their own life and do something actually themselves. But again, as you're saying, the doing on that deeper level, right? It's not the surface level stuff of, you know, I have to this or that, right?
So no, it's not moving physical stuff around. Mm-hmm. You know, that's not the doing. The doing is has to do with making a choice. Mm-hmm. A choice, you know, how to be.
Yes.
What's important to you. And you can go to training courses, and the training course may give you all sorts of wonderful information, but if it doesn't change how you are, if it doesn't change you at a fundamental level and make you a different person, then it's now it's you with a whole bunch of new facts in your head. So what, right? You with a whole bunch of new facts in your head aren't any better off than you were without those facts in your head. You're not a better person just because you have more facts in your head, or that you can repeat things, or that you can say things in a way that makes you appear to be wise, whether you are or not. You know, that's not the thing. So it really, you know, you really have to take the responsibility to change yourself at a very fundamental level so that you really become a different person. And that scares people.
Yes.
And some people think that that is very difficult. Mostly what's difficult is to screw up the courage to do it. The actual execution of it is not nearly as difficult as creating the intent, you know, to actually get it done. That's the hardest part. Once you've done that, the rest of it flows pretty easily, actually.
Well, it's so true. And, you know, I think the examples, again, for anyone listening, are so innumerable. Even on a practical level, how many people we have today trying to lose weight, reading every book, trying every program, rather than making that focused, conscious intent or decision, that choice, that, you know, to really actually change, not that any book or any program is going to get them to change. So that's very, very powerful.
Right. And often, just with the example you give, we focus on the wrong thing. See, we focus on losing weight. We shouldn't focus on losing weight. We should focus on eating healthily. You see, there's a difference. If you focus on losing weight, then you have this goal, and it really doesn't have to do with nutrition as much as it has to do with calorie counting and, you know, binge dieting and all these other things that maybe will make a temporary difference, but they don't make a fundamental difference because nothing has changed on a fundamental level. So if you want to lose weight, forget about losing weight and want to eat a healthy diet. Now, if you just eat a healthy diet, you'll lose weight. Your weight will come to where it needs to be for you. And in general, it'll be a real slim weight because a real slim body type is what's most healthy. You know, slim people live longer. Mm-hmm. You know, they have less chronic disease. They just do better physically, as well as whether it's emotionally and spiritually. You know, yeah. It's just hard. It's hard to get there, but don't focus on the weight. The weight's not the issue. The weight is a symptom. It's not the problem. You see, focus on health. Make sure that every bite you take has a very high nutrition to calorie, you know, ratio. Mm-hmm. Don't eat empty calories. Don't eat junk food. And it's, yeah, but it tastes so good. You know, what tastes good? Well, grease and sugar, right? Sweet grease. That's called a cookie, right? Sweet grease. And that's what tastes good. Yeah. That's what people do. And now it's all about, I don't make decisions and choices because it's my good intent and it's the right thing to do. I make decisions and choices because it feels good. Mm-hmm. You see, if that's your motivation behind your choice, I'll do whatever feels good, then you're not going to go anywhere except down. You know, that's going to end up as a recipe for, you know, self-destruction.
Yes.
If you just follow what feels good. And so many people are in this feels good, you know, on this feels good treadmill sort of thing. And they'll do it as long as it feels good. They'll approach it and be interested in it if it feels good. And if it doesn't feel good, then eventually it just disappears. All right, so you start this diet. And on this diet, you know, do things and you start to lose weight, but it doesn't feel good. You don't like the diet. It interferes with, you know, your social life. It interferes with all kinds of things. And it doesn't really work that well. And, well, forget it. You know, it's gone. In a month, you're not doing that anymore. Your weight's just back where it was, if not more. And you're very depressed about the fact, oh, I've tried. I just can't lose weight. Well, what you haven't tried to do is just make good choices about what you eat. You see, if you make good choices about what you eat, your weight will take care of itself. You don't have to worry about it. That's a symptom. It's not a problem. Yeah.
And that's such an important part, too, that we're going to be touching upon some more, because health, of course, is one of our major everyday aspects and something that I know many people struggle with understanding on a broader level, especially on the greater reality sort of understanding. So before we get to that, the one other question I wanted to ask you and bring up is when we speak about goals and speak about, you know, success and this idea of doing, of course, the first and main place that this is evident in most people's lives is their work or career choice. For some of us today, of course, they're struggling just to have a job, any job will do, etc., while others can pick or feel like they can pick and have the choice of, you know, whatever it is that they'd love to do. But no matter where we find ourselves on the spectrum, how do you help people understand the bigger ramifications of the work that we choose to do or most of the day or spend the majority of our time doing, how it impacts us and our growth and the evolution of the system as a whole?
Okay, well, there's a big impact. What you do all day long should have a major impact on who you are and what you do if you approach it correctly. At work all day, you make choices. It's what you do. So all of us do, no matter what the job is, whether we're sweeping a street, you know, or doing brain surgery, we make choices. And the quality of those choices, again, making them for the right reasons, with the right intent, is what it's all about. It doesn't matter that much what you do. It doesn't matter that much what your career is. If you realize that whatever it is you do, you will probably interact with other people. Most of our jobs or whatever, they're people interaction. Very seldom do we go away and sit by ourselves in a closet, you know, with the door shut and get paid for it. Mostly you have to interact with people. You have to do things with others. And all of those interactions give us opportunities to grow and learn. So if whatever you do, you get to interact with people, you get to make choices, and the reason you're here in this reality is to interact with people and make good choices so that you evolve, well then, what difference does the job really make? You see, it's what you make of it is important. If you get your ego twisted around how important your job is or how unimportant it is, and that makes you unhappy or happy or whatever, that's the problem. It's not the job. It's your attitude. You see, it's, of course, the job has to at least give you enough income that you can, you know, get by winter in a warm spot, you know, and get enough to eat. But once you have basics covered, the job is really an opportunity for you to interact with people, to do whatever it is you do, to do what you do, do it with pride, you know, do it with, you know, do as good a job as you can, even if it is just making a street clean. Make it really clean, you see. Take pride in what you do. And if you have that and your interaction with people is good, you're interacting with caring, with love, then your job will be wonderful. You'll even enjoy the job, even if it's a very mundane or, you know, you might think trivial job. No job is really a trivial job. If it didn't have to be done, nobody would be paying you money to do it. It's what, excuse me, it's what you make of the job that's important. What do you, you know, what do you bring to it? What is your attitude toward it? If it's, wow, okay, here I am and my job is to get this street clean, you know, and, you know, I can do that in a grumpy way. You know, I can just make a lot of dust and don't care who it gets on, and I can, you know, be grouchy about who's in my way because I want to sweep this corner right now and there's people standing there. I can just kind of sweep it up someplace where nobody will notice it and leave it. You see, I've got all kinds of ways I can approach it. But those then will let you go home and feel bad about what you did all day. But if you do as good a job as you can, and if your interactions are always thoughtful and caring and helpful, you will have a good job no matter what you do. Mm-hmm. And it'll be a job that will allow you to learn and grow, which is your point for being here. Our point for being here isn't how much money can we make, you know, what a good time we have, you know, how good can we feel. That's not it. It's to grow, to interact. And there'll be lots of challenges. Even if you sweep a street, there's somebody who needs help. There's somebody that's got too many packages to carry. There's somebody who's lost and needs directions. There's somebody, you know, that you can help, that you can be helpful to, even if it's just to get the garbage out of their way so they don't have to walk through it. And that's the attitude. So our doing out there in a job is an opportunity. See it as an opportunity. Don't judge it as how much status goes with this job and am I getting paid, you know, as much as the somebody else that's doing the job. And if you start making these comparisons and it starts to become a status issue, and if you've covered your basic economic needs but you still need more because you want more, and that drives you to be dissatisfied with your job, then, you know, these things can all become problems.
Yeah.
Now, I don't mean that you should just stay in some menial task just because, you know, that's what you've got. Sure, you can have ambition. Sure, you can plan to get that education you need to get that better job. Sure, you can, you know, work your way up in the organization. That's a challenge, too. That's a challenge to learn more skills, you know, more things, mm-hmm. make yourself more valuable so you can do more. Generally, out in the workplace, you get paid according to the value of your work, you know, and as your work gets to where there's fewer and fewer people that can do it the way you do, you become more valuable. So sure, work yourself up into that. I'm not saying that you shouldn't really care about what you do, mm-hmm. but you should go, you know, get a broom and sweep a street. It's just that don't make that the important part of the job. The important part of the job is how well can I do it? How much can I learn? How can I interact with people to make a difference in right. their lives? Those are the key those are the key things. And if you do that, you'll just kind of float up in that job category, whatever it is, you know, without you trying to do anything, because you will make yourself valuable. You'll learn more. You'll work harder. You see, once you start feeling like you're very focused on the idea, am I getting enough? Am I appreciated? Then this is all about you. You know, it's all about, what about me? You know, more poor me, you know, I've got this job and it sucks and nobody appreciates me and so on. Then that will just make you miserable. That's yes. the wrong attitude. That's the ego and the fear and the beliefs making you miserable, which is what they'll do.
Now, Tom, what about in our society today, of course, as we are at a greater time, as many see it, of awakening? And we know that there are many we'll call them corporations, that are what appears to the system as a whole working against the greater evolution. And perhaps it is, you know, in direct examples of destroying nature or destroying, you know, human worth, value, just anything, you know, that deals with some sort of injustice. What if we find ourselves working for such a company or job? Can we still maintain, you know, our own learning while we know we're supporting something that perhaps doesn't resonate with evolving the greater good?
Well, you know, that's a choice of personal integrity. If you have integrity, then you don't want to be working toward, you know, enslaving, you know, children someplace, right? That's not a nice thing. You don't want to be doing things that you feel are wrong. You don't want to be contributing toward higher entropy, right? The idea is right choice is contributing toward lower entropy, toward becoming love. So if you have a job where you are creating problems, then you probably should look for another job. You probably ought to see if you can't find something that suits you better. You don't really want to be contributing to that thing. Now, we can get ourselves all twisted up in a wad over that as well. You know, we can get down to the point that it says, well, do you pay taxes? Oh, you do? Then you're supporting, you know, this, you know, you're supporting the war efforts. You're supporting all these horrible things. You should refuse to pay taxes and go to jail. You know, we can get that down to the point where it's ridiculous. We can't do anything. You know, there's absolutely nothing you can do that doesn't probably somehow, you know, you can't turn it into something that's not as positive as you'd like it to be. Well, we don't have to be perfect people creating a perfect world. You know, that's not really what we're here. We're here to deal with the world that we're in. That's the name of the game. Stuff happens, we deal with it. Now, if you're in an organization and you think that organization has some integrity issues, you're much better able to change that organization from the inside than you are from the outside. For instance, if you constantly are kind of pointing out the other side of the picture or what's wrong you know, having conversations, talking up the right side of things, you're much more effective there than you are on the outside, shaking your fist and, you know, calling them names. That doesn't change them at all. So there's another side. If you are a cause of good and working toward love, that you are inside of an organization that is not, well, you're a little ray of light in there. Yeah. You know, let that light shine. And you would lose integrity if you hid that light and just contributed to the, you know, whatever you thought the evil corporation was doing and didn't voice any opposition or didn't voice any, here's another way. But you don't have to do that stridently. It's not like if you don't get out on the ramparts and shake your fist and curse the evil enemy, then you're a part of the problem. That's not the case. If you do get out there and shake your fist and curse the enemy, you're a part of the problem. See, all that does, it makes the enemy, if you will, retrench deeper.
Right.
It makes him more more focused on their goals. It just hardens their position. So basically, you're going to get a lot more value by just being who you are, letting that light shine. And if it shines into some dark places, all the better. You see, so we don't have to take it that personally. We have, if we're going to live here and deal with this country, these politics, you know, the things we don't like, well, we also, if we're going to live here, we have to put up with the rules, whether we like them or not. So the rules say you pay taxes. You earn money, you pay taxes. So you pay your taxes. But you still fuss and fume and you don't like this and you don't want to support the war and you vote in ways that vote against it, and that's what we're supposed to be doing. It's not like you have to be pure, you know, by not associating with anything that isn't also pure. That's a hallucination. And in general, that is more being part of the problem than it is part of the solution. That's a lot of people being, you know, holier than thou, you know, purer than the rest, and that isn't helpful. It's more helpful to go in there where the lepers live and treat them, help them, be kind to them. Show them what a positive person based on love is like, what those decisions would be like. And that does a whole lot more good than calling them names and telling them they're, you know, they're evil people that need to change their ways. That doesn't help much at all.
Well, I mean, your advice is brilliant, and especially again now as we, for the past few years on this planet, seems to be facing more and more turmoil of a dual nature, whether it's, you know, the, what was it, the Occupy Wall Street to the GMO labeling. You know, there's so many issues, core issues that our society seems to be facing that is seems to be separating more and more people into the, you know, us against them rather than trying to, as you said, you know, just
Yes.
be the light wherever you are. So absolutely brilliant. Brilliant. Thank you for sharing that. Now,
if you push people into opposition with each other, you generally have made the problem worse, not better. So polarization is never a good thing.
Yeah.
It's not that you want to punish the people who are doing it wrong. It's that you want to help educate them and have them want to do it right. You can't force them to change. You
right.
can't force anybody to change except yourself. You're the only person that you can change. So going out with the idea, I have to change these people. You know, they've got the wrong attitude. They're doing this wrong.
Yeah.
You know, I need to go change them. That's just arrogance. I know what's right. They don't. I need to change them. And of course, they're thinking they know what's right. You don't. And they need to change you. So let's just, you know, duke it out and, you know, and fight and scream and try to hurt each other. That's counterproductive. It doesn't, you know, that doesn't really help. It makes an ego feel better.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm on the side of right. I was out on the barricades all day occupying Wall Street. I was doing this and I was doing that. So they feel better about themselves. Well, okay, it helps an ego feel self-satisfied.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't help the world change.
Right.
For the most part. Now, you have to, I say that in general. You know, there are places where you can do things to help the world change.
Right.
And by all means, do them. But as soon as you get driven mm-hmm. by your ego and driven by your fear and beliefs, you become ineffective. You're not going to make the difference you think. You know, how many
yes.
places do we have? Totalitarian governments? The revolution comes. The revolutionaries supplant the old totalitarian government and give us a new totalitarian government. Right? That happens all the time. You know, where you think you're on the side of right and beauty and justice and so on, and you're going to change the world. If you haven't changed yourself, you won't change the world, you see.
Yes.
All you're doing is casting in the same old thing in a different way. So you end up with just a new tyranny rather than the old tyranny, because the people who fought the old tyranny didn't win the battle in themselves first.
Mm-hmm.
They got to, you know, they weren't ready when they got there to do it right. All they did then is assume power. And now they're the tyranny. So we don't want that. That's not. That's really not helpful in the big picture to replace one, you know, raving bunch of maniacs with another raving bunch of maniacs. That doesn't get you anywhere very, very,
right.
very far. The thing about money is that money is neither good nor bad. You know, it's not an evil thing, you know, to have money. that it often causes bad is not the fault of money. It's our fault. Okay. So let's say you have money, and because you have a lot of money, you end up with more fear that you won't have it, somebody will take it away from you, you'll lose it, etc. Ego, mm-hmm. about being better than other people, beliefs, expectations, the way people should treat you, you know. So you get all this stuff, but it's not the money that's the problem. It's you that's the problem. The money doesn't make you like that. You are like that,
mm-hmm.
or you act that way, you see. So money's not good or money's not bad. Money's just money. It's a way of exchanging goods without having to bring your chicken to market to change it, you know, for a, you know, a piece of metal.
Yes.
You know, money's just convenient. That's all. Money's not evil. It's the people that need to change. Changing the money isn't going to do it. You know, if we could just get rid of the money, you know, then everybody would happily ever after. It doesn't work that way. You know, we have utopians have been around for a long time trying to get their vision of utopia to work.
Mm-hmm.
And all the various economic systems we have, they're all utopian systems. Capitalism is a utopian system. You know, you have Adam Smith's invisible hand that will move everything around just, you know, so that as you have more demand than the manufacturing base will raise to meet it. You know, everything works great. And it would be a wonderful system, except it's not populated by perfect people. You have people who are greedy, who are arrogant, who are all these things, And that's what makes the system not work. It's the same with socialism. It's the same with communism. It's the same with all of these systems. They're all utopian systems that would work terrifically if it was just populated by perfect people who were just full of love and interest in, you know, helping other people out, right?
Yeah.
But we don't have those perfect people. Yeah. And if you don't have those perfect people, you can't make people act like they're perfect by instituting a rule set over them. That doesn't work. It just annoys them and makes them want to get rid of your rule set. You see, it just causes another revolution. So those things don't work. The interesting thing is that if you had the perfect people to begin with, the people who were based on love, any economic system would work as good as any other. Because what would happen is that the system would just do whatever it did because it was interested in helping other people, you see, with these perfect people. It would be a wonderful system. You wouldn't have to impose it. You wouldn't need a bunch of rules. It would just create itself. So if you have, if you can make the spiritual quality, if you can make the quality of consciousness better, the economic system, the political system will all just fall right into line and be wonderful.
Right.
And if you don't have the quality of consciousness, it doesn't matter what kind of system you impose, it won't work. Because at the base, we are who we are. And you can have any sort of system. Oh, here's a system of sharing. We're all going to share. But because some people are greedy, then some people want more than others. Well, I'm worth more than others, so, you know, it always is a problem. So that's the thing with money. It's not the economic system that's bad. It's not our money system that's bad. It's not all of those things. Those are symptoms.
Right.
All of those things are symptoms of a low quality of consciousness. It's the quality of consciousness that's not very good that's the problem. And again, by working on the symptom, like working on your weight and refusing to even think about nutrition, isn't going to get you there. Working on, oh, here's the system that, you know, we can all live by and we'll all live happily ever after, isn't going to work as long as that system is populated by people who are full of fear and beliefs. It just won't work.
Right.
You can't legislate good behavior. People have to be who they are, act the way they are. So the money system is not the problem. It's the symptom. It's because we're the way we are that we've generated the money system that we have, you see? It's not the money system makes us evil. It's that because we are who we are, that we generate this money system that allows us to, you know, abuse other people. That's the way to look at that. So money, economic systems, you know, whether you're, you know, whether you're a capitalist or a socialist or some other kind of ist is not the point. That's mostly some sort of intellectual, I don't know, intellectual blather that makes people feel good because it makes them feel like they have the answer. And if we're just this way, if we could just get everybody to be this way, you know, it would work. Well, that's just arrogance.
Yes.
If you just got everybody to be that way, it wouldn't work because they'd still be the same people. So after the revolution is over, you just have another set of dictators.
Yeah.
It wouldn't work out because somebody wants to be the dictator because somebody's greedy and somebody's arrogant and somebody has power and they're going to use all of that stuff to get what they want the way they want it because that's the way they are. That's the extent of their growth. So that's the economic. The economic angle is it really doesn't matter about the system or the money. You could be very, very wealthy and be a wonderfully grown person. You can be very, very poor and be a wonderfully grown person. The money doesn't matter.
Right.
You know, the money's just there. It's the system that represents us. That's why we have this government we have. It's because it represents us. If you say, well, this government worries me because they seem to act a little fascist sometimes, you know, imposing this and let's bomb them, you know, nuke them, you know. What is it with these people? Well, look at the electorate. That's the way the electorate feels. The government just represents us. So it's not the government's fault. It's we the people. We are what we get.
You know, this is such a refreshing, again, view because so often nowadays people are so focused on, again, taking one side over the other. And what you said is just comes right down back to us and our responsibility, our accountability for us to focus on our growing up while holding the greater good in our, of course, perspective and such. So And just before we wrap up the idea of, you know, work, money, and economics and such, when we do look at the overall picture on this planet today, we do, in general, have a sense of things that one could say are trying to sort of keep us asleep, to keep, you know, the everyday in and outs going, the consumerism, the materialism, the whateverism that we've talked about. But when people are listening to this and thinking, okay, so I want to grow up, but I find all this other stuff always pulls me in or so lucrative. Is there any advice that you would offer people here as to, okay, so how do we sort of, you know, not negate what is, but at the same time not fall like a zombie or a victim to what is or asleep to what is?
Okay. First of all, nobody can pull you in. Nobody can force you to be anything other than what you are. And only you can change you. Okay, this idea about, oh, so-and-so made me angry. So-and-so doesn't make you angry. Right. You choose to get angry. You see, you have to take full responsibility. It's not that the society and the manipulative industrialists and all the people that are doing things to pull you in, they can't do anything to you. You see, it's not that they can make you this way or that way. They are not the problem. Again, that's a refusal to take responsibility for yourself and blaming it on somebody else. Well, I would be a really good person, except I live in this really crappy place, you see, and they have all these rules, and they're unfair, and they're not nice, they're always manipulating me. Well, that may be true, but that doesn't mean that you can't be a wonderful person. You can anyway. Don't use that as an excuse for why you're not grown. If you're not grown, that's your fault. It's nobody else's fault. Nobody else makes you, you know, have a poor intent or have beliefs or have fears. You accept those fears. They're okay. Yours, and they're only yours to get rid of. So first of all, we don't blame anybody else for us being the way we are. We are the way we are because that's us, and we need to outgrow it. We can outgrow it in almost any kind of an environment. It doesn't take a real happy little environment to outgrow it. Look at Viktor Frankl.
Yes.
You know, Viktor Frankl, now he's in a concentration camp, being physically, emotionally, mentally abused every day. His family is murdered. He has all these things. And how does he deal with that? Okay, that's a terrible environment. That's not just some corporation trying to steal his wallet. That's some real heavy-duty meanness coming his way. And he comes out of it a better person than when he went in, with a bigger picture. Mm-hmm. And a bigger understanding of the way people work. He doesn't come out bitter. He doesn't come out, you know, mentally, you know, ill. He doesn't come out angry. He comes out with a bigger idea of how it all works. So that's just an example, you know, of how that works. It's that your environment, okay, it may be oppressive. There are hands trying to grab money out of your wallet, you know, all the time. And that may be annoying, but listen, that's where we live. Okay, we live in that neighborhood, and that neighborhood's the way it is because the way we people are. How do you change we the people? How do you make people grow up? Well, you don't make people do anything. The only people you can make do something is yourself, and mostly we don't even do that. So let's do what we can do.
Yes.
Let's make ourselves more grown, and then we don't have to go out and teach or force, certainly not force. Just be who you are. Again, be that light shining in the darkness. You will change more people just by giving them a good example than you will ever change them by lecturing to them. You see, you will do more good just by being a good example than to go around telling people how they ought to be. You see, it's not helpful to them. That's not helpful at all. All you do is annoy them. You don't make them any better. We don't learn through our intellects. It's at the being level.
Mm-hmm.
So if you change yourself, then you are doing the optimum thing that you can do to make this whole society better. And you're doing it much more effectively than by, you know, organizing and you know, trying to throw back those that throw at you, then you're going to throw it back at them. Well, you've just joined the fray, you see. You're not part of the solution. You become part of the problem. You exacerbate the problem. So that's the thing that we can do. We don't have to feel manipulated in this world. Okay, we are manipulated in many ways. You know, that's just the way it is. That's our neighborhood. What about the people that live in really, really bad neighborhoods, places that have a lot of crime? Well, they're stuck there. Unless they can move, they have to deal with it. But you don't deal with it by joining it, and you don't deal with it by getting a bigger gun and fighting it.
Right.
That just makes it worse. You just escalate the violence that way. You deal with it by changing yourself. And if enough people change themselves, the whole system will take care of itself. If enough people refuse to change themselves because, oh, the system's against me, then we're still stuck with the same system. So, yeah, there's a system out there that picks your pocket, that, you know, does things that you don't like. It intrudes on your freedoms. It forces you to do things you don't want to do. It makes you pay taxes and support armies that do what you don't want them to do. But that's our neighborhood. That's where we live. And we change it by changing ourselves. That's the most effective way to change it. Otherwise, like I say, you just get a different set of despots. You know, if somebody put most of us in charge, we wouldn't do much better than the people who are there. You know, if you just take a, it's not that these people who get to the top are so evil that they, you know, are trying to do all these awful things. It's, they're very much like the rest of us. The only reason we're not so evil is that we don't have that much power.
Right.
You see, all we can do when we come home is holler at the wife and kick the dog. You know, that's as much damage as we can do in the world because we're powerless. Well, give us a country to run. Wow, now we can nuke people and we can do all kinds of things instead of holler at the wife and kick the dog. So it's not that those people on top are just kind of the evil cream of the evil crop. They're just like us. Except they have power, so they get to really kick a lot of dogs, you know, and holler at a lot of wives and create a lot of dysfunction in the world rather than just a little bit of dysfunction maybe in a family or a neighborhood. So we have to stop thinking of ourselves as us and them.
Right.
We're the good guys. They're the bad guys. They're not that much different than we are. It's just that they have to be. They happen to be in positions of power where they can make a lot bigger mess of it than we can.
Right.
If we were there, we'd probably make as big a mess as they did unless we had gotten our own ego and fears and expectations and beliefs under control. They don't have theirs under control, so they act the way they act. We don't have ours under control, so we act the way we act. They control a lot of big stuff, you know, control a lot of big guns, and we don't. So all we can do is our small thing. But it's not us against them.
Yeah.
It's just like, let's us grow up. Take care of us. And they will then take care of themselves, because once most of the people in this nation or in any group are grown up, then the leadership, the government, the economics, all the rest of it just works.
That's
all
right.
By itself, just because people will want to be doing the right thing, you see. And until it gets grown up, nothing's going to work.
Right.
So just get yourself, you know, like I told that young woman, just get your head on straight, act natural, and the rest of it will take care of itself. And that works for everything.
Well, excellent advice, Tom. And I think for really any of us who are familiar with the idea of the macrocosm versus the microcosm, or just that our reality reflects itself to us, or we are a reflection of it, it just all seems to work and point exactly at what you are saying, that, you know, what we are seeing outside of ourselves is in some way or another a representation of ourselves. So until or as long as we see something we don't like, I think it's just like a signal for us to maybe work on or look at what is it inside of ourselves or something within us that could be, you know, changed, or how we could grow up to have a better reflection on a macrocosm level.
Exactly. We have this wrong idea that we look outside in the outside world and say we don't like it, then we need to go out and change it and make it more like the way we want it to be. Well, you see the problem with that? If everybody feels that way, if everybody wants to go out and make it the way they think it's right, then you're back to war, right? You're just back to fighting and fussing, and nothing ever really happens. That's not the way to change things. And then, of course, people would say, yeah, but, you know, I'm right and they're wrong. And that's not helpful either. The thing to do is say, well, let me just change what I can change.
Yes.
And that's me. As opposed to let me change other people to be the way I want them to be. That's just arrogance.